My wife is very tolerant of my hobby. My hobby is sort of difficult for her to comprehend, but she's a very understanding woman. Well, like most addictions, I didn't realize that I had a problem until my wife began to get after me about, were you going to put one more typewriter? Because I had half a dozen, and then the next thing I knew, I had 80. I think that I have about 200 typewriters at this point. We're at Gold Rush in Orinoco. I'm trying to find a good deal on a typewriter or two. I hike barefoot when I can. It feels better. On hot days, this asphalt gets a little warm and I have flip-flops in my backpack. Actually works. As a hobby, this is probably a niche hobby. There are an estimated about 2,000 collectors in the entire world. My collection is probably one of the larger ones in the upper Midwest.
The decals up here are in good shape. What down here is in decent shape.
If I've never seen it before, I consider it worth buying. But it's pretty exciting to come across something that you might call a diamond in the rough. Well, one example of a diamond in the rough I found was the Keaton. What we have here is a Keaton Music typewriter, which is kind of a rare little machine that was made for composers, music schools, small publishing companies to make master copies, that sort of thing. It was actually in an antique dealer's storage barn. When I went in, I just asked him if he had any typewriters, and he said, well, I've got this music typewriter in the back, if you're interested in that. And I said, sure. And unlike most music typewriters, this one types straight down onto the flat page. The thing adjusts, so you can type up and down that staff. And that one's worth about 10 times what I paid for it. This is the typewriter that I found in the alley behind my house that was being snowed on. Well, one of my favorite collecting moments was when I happened to come home from work one day and saw a couple of typewriters sitting on the trunk of my neighbor's car out in the alley behind my house. I asked them if they were going to throw them out, and they said, yeah, do you want them? And that turned out to be my Remington Noiseless 6 and my Calligraph 4. And the Calligraph 4 is one of the scarcer machines. Worth a little bit, definitely collectible, and so that was really exciting to find. My first memory of using a typewriter was the 1926 Underwood No. 5 that my grandfather kept in his basement. That was my very first. I spent a lot of hours and wrote a lot of bad teenage prose on it. It's really hard to explain why you love something. Why classic cars? Why old records? Why cameras? Typewriters just appeal to me on a very personal, emotional level, more so than other antiques. The main thing that I get out of having all these typewriters is getting to use all the different kinds and experiencing what it was like to type on them back when they were new. Also, some of them are really rich with history, and to lay your fingers on those keys and to type on them is, you know, really kind of exciting. I often think about the people who used these typewriters before me, and sometimes the people who made them. Ah, this one. This one I did not realize when I bought it that it was in fact a, for all purposes, a Nazi typewriter. That one was produced under the Third Reich, and it does have the double lightning bolt SS key on it. And this was in fact probably made by slave laborers, Frenchmen or Ukrainian women. It was pretty sobering when I got this. I didn't realize that it had that SS key on it, that this was a Nazi typewriter. It was pretty sobering to realize, you know, the hands that probably used these and the hands that made it. I think collecting typewriters has a cultural significance because they were so important to American culture, actually worldwide culture, for the greater part of the 20th century. It's been said that typewriters enabled women to enter the workforce and, you know, took them out of the house. A lot of the original marketing campaigns for the typewriters were aimed at women in the office place. And like many advertisements from that period, some of them are very sexist in nature, such as the Woodstock ads featuring the guy with the bushy mustache pecking away, and it's saying, if you had to do it yourself. The implication being, well, of course you're never going to actually type a letter yourself because you have your secretary to do that, but if you did have to, our machine is so easy to use, you could. But in a way, it did make a lot of women more independent back in the early 1900s, and there's a significance in that too. Nobody can say for sure who really invented the typewriter. Eventually, everything that we know today as a modern typewriter can be traced back to the Remington number 2. As far as your basic design, even the QWERTY keyboard. Back when typewriters first hit the market, there was a bit of a backlash against them because typed correspondence was considered too informal. Handwritten letters were considered personal, and that's what a lot of people wanted to get. Really, the stenographers, you know, people who took dictation and wrote in shorthand, those were probably the people who had the most to do with breaking typewriters into the mainstream because they loved it. To some extent, each design reflects its own time in history. The Depression-era typewriters reflect that period in time, because before then you had the big, stocky, sometimes very ornate machines, and then right about 1930 to 31, you start seeing these tiny, fragile portables come out. What I've got here is sort of an example of the evolution of one particular line of Royal Depression-era typewriters that started out with the Royal Signet in 1932, and this was $19, very no frills, all caps, you know, so there's no shift, just a bare metal space bar there. And so you see these Depression era machines as sort of a reflection of that very hard time in our country. Most kids born after, say, 1990 probably never used a typewriter in their lives. I think that people who have grown up using only computers and have never used a typewriter are missing out on something because they've missed out on that direct connection between the printed word on the paper and what they type. They press a key, make a letter, and right now you're just pushing electrons. And I don't think there's a personal connection there to the work that they're doing. There's kind of a craftsmanship in the printed page. I think people are missing out on the intimacy of the writing experience. Using a typewriter forces you to be a little more careful about what you write. There's no spell check. You can't easily go back and delete what you wrote if you wrote the wrong word. I think typewriters force a person to slow down and think more about what they're going to write. And I think the end result of what a person does write is a little more polished than what they would just dash out on a computer. One of the things that separates typewriters from most other antiques is that most antiques you don't get to use, but typewriters you can. The computer did not make typewriters obsolete. They just made the act of writing different. And I think if these people would sit down to a keyboard, they might find they really enjoyed the experience. Oh, I'm going to keep collecting for as long as I can. I like feeling the keys underneath my fingers and pushing those type slugs and pressing the ink onto the page and making a word.